Hi, I'm Rashmi, and I am a Solutions Architect at Amazon Web Services. Welcome to the second video in the Policy Development Series for Amazon Verified Permissions. If you haven't watched the previous video, then it's highly recommended that you watch the first video. You can find the link in the description below. In this video, we'll understand what is a schema in Amazon Verified Permissions, why is it important to use a schema, demo on how to create a schema for a wet application use case, and next steps. In the last video, we introduced the wet application and discussed the AWS recommended framework to build authorization. We want to build a portal for a wet clinic. This portal allows pet owners to register their pets, create appointments with veterinarians or vets, and provides them with the ability to read their pets' medical records and test results. This portal is not just for pet owners. Vets will also log into this portal, and they can read the details about the animal, and it allows the vets to update the medical records and any test results that were conducted. As you must have realized, there are multiple levels of authorization needed in this case. We have two different actors or principals, that is pet owners and vets. We have different set of records or resources related to the pet and need to provide the appropriate authorization for each API or action. But creating authorization becomes simpler when we follow a framework for designing and implementing authorization in our application. So let's take a look at the authorization framework. We introduced the Amazon Verified Permissions recommended framework in the last video to build authorization for our portal. In this video, we'll be discussing the second step, which is to define the schema and policies. If you'd like to learn more about step 1, which is to define permissions model, then please watch the first video in the series. Before we dive deep into understanding schemas in Amazon Verified Permissions, let's understand what is a schema. A policy schema refers to a structured framework or blueprint that outlines the key elements and components of a policy. Essentially, it's a way to make sure everyone involved in building the application understands how things are supposed to be organized and what they are supposed to be called. It provides the guardrails or constraints that ensures all application policies are meaningful and will function as expected. For example, via schemas, you can mandate the naming convention of a pet name to be in string format rather than any random naming convention, which can cause confusion in later stages of policy evaluation. But why is it important to define a schema? Can I not create permission policies without creating a schema? Well, the answer is you can build policies without a schema. The use of schemas in Amazon Verified Permissions is optional, but they are highly recommended for production software. Let's consider a scenario where we don't have a defined schema. Let's say, as you start building the portal, a developer created the following permissions policy. This first policy reflects a permission rule that owners can view their pet's records. Now your portal becomes really popular and you want to add more owners and records, and someone created another policy for owner Sam. As you must have realized, there are typo errors. Amazon Verified Permissions uses Cedar language, as we learned in the previous video. Cedar can't know whether the policy for owner Sam is right or wrong by examining it in isolation. For example, Cedar doesn't know if the policy author meant pet owner or the incorrect spelling of pet owner, because both are well-formed names. If the policies were subsequently evaluated during an authorization decision, it would not match at all due to the mistakes in the policy scope. Moreover, if we think about types of actions, two developers could define similar actions that might mean the same or different things and cause conflicts. For example, let's consider a situation where one action is view and the other is read, and both have been defined differently by different developers. We want to manage and enforce consistent policies across an application. If no policy grants access, CEDAR returns a default decision of deny. However, it can be frustrating when a policy isn't behaving as expected. To avoid this frustration, it is better to learn that a policy is invalid when you're creating it, so that mistakes can be fixed before they have an impact on your application's operation. So, how do we handle this? The answer is schemas. Schemas validate the policies as they are created within the system. A schema provides the guardrails for a policy structure. Now, let's see how to create schemas for our use case in action via a demo. We'll go to Amazon Verified Permissions from the console. We'll start by creating an empty policy store. We'll name a policy store Veterinary Portal. Because we'll be using schemas to validate our policies, we need to turn on the validation mode. Now, every single policy that you create will be validated against the schema. If you don't have the schema, then the policy validations will fail. Now let's create a policy store. We can now start creating a schema. Entity types and actions in Amazon Verified Permissions will be nested under a namespace. Let's call our namespace Veterinary Portal. In Amazon Verified Permissions, all principles, resources are just entity types. Let's start defining our entity types. We'll create a first entity type called Pet Owner. For simple policies and policy models, we need not worry about parents, and we recommend that you don't use them. For large, complex policy stores, the parent context adds a hierarchy of relationships that improves policy indexing, but it also affects how you call the isAuthorized function. I can use the attribute field if I want to authorize owners based on certain attributes. In this case, I want to authorize only those owners whose email addresses are verified. Hence, I'll create a Boolean attribute isEmailVerified. Because I don't want the customers to do anything unless they have verified email addresses. We'll also add an attribute called ClinicID. This is in case we want to restrict access to our veterinary portal from certain locations in future policies. We'll also add an attribute called type. You'll see the use of type attribute in the next video when we create policies. Adding a type attribute will help us avoid having to create policies for each user. Let's add a pet owner entity type. Now that we have created our principle, that is pet owner, let's now create a resource. In this example, resource is medical records. Each pet has an owner, and I want to establish a relation between the pet owner and the medical record of the pet. because I have defined pet owner as the entity already. I can create an attribute called owner, and in attribute type, I can select pet owner. I'll also add the attribute clinic ID. Next, we define what actions a principal, that is pet owner, can take on the resource, that is medical records. As you know, pet owners should be allowed to register their pets and view the medical record of their pets. Let's define a first action name as read medical records. For this example, we won't be selecting an action group. But if you want to group a set of actions together, then you can make use of the action group. For example, you can group all read-based actions such as view and list into an action group called read. Similarly, you can add all write-based actions such as create, update, delete into an action group called write. Next, we'll select our principal and the resource type. In this case, the principal is pet owner, and the resource is medical records. The applies to section is really important as it binds the principals to particular resource types. Context is additional set of attributes that you might want to use when making authorization decisions. In our case, let's define the context attribute is MFA authenticated. And define it as type Boolean. We'll now add our action. We have defined one principal, one resource type, and one action. Let's define our other entity type, pet. I now want to establish a relation between the pet owner and the pet. Because I have defined pet owner as the entity already, I can select pet owner from the attribute type, and I can add an attribute called owner. I'll again add the attribute clinic ID. We will now define another action, register pet, for the pet owner. We'll select our principal, which in this case is the pet owner, and our resource, which in this case is the pet itself. And we'll add our action. Next, we'll add vet as another entity. We'll again add clinic ID as the attribute. We'll now define the actions for the vet. Vets should be able to view and update the pet medical records. We'll create the action update medical records. We'll select our principal, that is vet, and the resource, which in this case is the medical record. As you know, vets also need to be able to view the medical records. But because we have already created an action read medical records for pet owners, we need not create a separate one for vets. We'll simply edit the existing action read medical records and add vet as the principal. We'll now save the changes made to our schema. Once we have created our schema, we can visualize it on this page to see if it adheres to our permissions model. As you can see, based on our schema, vets should be able to view and update the medical records. Pet owners should be able to register their pets and view the medical records. Note that schema file is not a policy. It does not grant or deny access to any resources. It merely defines the structure of the system. It is like a contract between the policy author and ceder. The policy author agrees to write policies that conform to the schema, and ceder agrees to validate policies against the schema. Now, let's relate the schema that we created in this demo to our original veterinary portal application. In this demo, we have created two different principles, that is, pet owners and veterinarians. We have created our resources, that is, pet and medical records. And finally, we have created appropriate level of authorization for each of the APIs. Congratulations! You have now translated a logical application permissions model into a CEDAR schema. In this video, you learned why is it important to create a schema for your use case, basic structure of a schema, and finally, you saw a demo on how to create a schema for a veterinary portal use case. In the next video, we will take this policy model and schema and start writing policies to lock down access to our application. To learn more about Amazon Verified Permissions and Schema, please scan the QR codes on the screen. Thank you.